Part 13 of 13 from set number 2005, introducing C.G. Jung's Red Book, a BC Recordings copyrighted presentation by Stephan Hoeller entitled, How to Approach and Understand the Red Book.
And with that, we shall proceed with this evening's discussion, the concluding observations and the transcendent function. Now, having now reviewed, at least in outline form, albeit, as you know, with copious quotations, the content of the Liber Novus, or popularly called the Red Book, we need to address ourselves now to some elements of both the content and the context of the Red Book, as well as to certain indications of what might be called a method or a process whereby it was obtained. As we all know, Jung was, by training, a psychologist, or as contemporary parlance would call a medical doctor who specializes in psychology, a psychiatrist. It is also generally known that Jung, as a youthful professional man, in the very early stages of his career, contacted Sigmund Freud, the Viennese psychologist, who at the time was still struggling against the opposition which his theories aroused in the profession and beyond. Yet it is quite clear that Jung was never really happy with his association with Freud, for he had an intuitively based resistance to Freud's materialistic and rationalistic attitude toward the human psyche. But at the same time, of course, Freud discovered, or perhaps one might say more correctly, rediscovered the unconscious, what came to be called the unconscious, and this was a tremendous discovery. It was certainly an attention-getter as far as Jung was concerned. Das Unbewusste, that which is not known, that which is not in consciousness. For the existence of this has been ignored and repressed by the scientific world for quite a long time. It, of course, existed under various names, particularly in the more esoteric traditions, throughout the history of Western culture, which, of course, would not have existed without an unconscious, but they did not call it that. Now, around 1904, Professor Bloiler, who was Jung's chief at the Burghölzli Hospital, introduced Freudian psychoanalysis, and 2 years later, Jung entered into communication with Freud. Prior to this time, Jung's work with mental patients was dominated by statistical and experimental methods, word association tests, combined with the theory of complexes. Interestingly enough, for quite a long time, it was these activities that gave Jung a certain amount of fame in the profession, although he considered them perhaps the most inferior products of his work and of his own consciousness ever. And so Freud's view of the unconscious might be said to have been the first giant step that Jung took in the direction of the mystery that was to exercise its hold on his soul and his life in future years, and indeed throughout his entire life. This is something that we need to consider, because in our times, and for quite some time now, those of us who are interested in these things bandy about the words unconscious and unconscious complexes and the unconscious in dreams and so forth quite freely and quite without too much affect. But just think, to discover back then in the early part of the 20th century to discover that there is an other reality, an other world as it were, that influences our consciously available reality, and that it is available to us by the way of changes alterations in our consciousness. What a tremendously exciting and tremendously creative news that was. It was certainly one of the major creative discoveries of, or rediscoveries of, Western culture. Now, the next giant step Jung took was precisely within the general period when he separated from Freud, almost as if renouncing the exclusivity of the personal unconscious, which it was, as far as Freud went in his theories, almost as if that became synonymous with renouncing Freud. When Jung discovered that the unconscious is much, much wider and much, much deeper, and indeed perhaps infinite in its dimensions, much deeper and wider than Freud ever imagined, well, that was the time when the two leading early psychologists parted company. This had to do with Jung's discovery of the collective unconscious, sometimes called the objective psyche, and basically the deeper and the deepest psychic reality of the human being. By 1912 and 1913, Jung became inspired to explore the symbols of the collective unconscious. The result of these explorations was a book, originally entitled Wandlungen und Symbole der Libido, which ultimately was reissued and included in the collected works of Jung as Symbols of Transformation. Jung knew that he was inspired to write this book. He was quite aware that the manner in which the ideas, the information came to him that was included in that book was very, very different from the manner in which he researched and wrote his various other books. But he did not know at the time in any way as to where this inspiration came from. But only after 1914 did he recognize that a figure, a being named Philemon, was the one who inspired that material. And indeed, in the autobiographical fragments, because that's really what they are, in Memories, Dreams, and Reflections, Jung stated quite clearly that Philemon taught him the meaning of symbols, and that the result of that was the book Symbols of Transformation. Freud was vehemently opposed to the contents of that book, and this became the final episode of the break between the two men. Dr. Shamdasani, in his introduction to the Red Book, throws some considerable light on the process or the procedure whereby the Red Book came to Jung, and I will share that with you now. We may have quoted some little portion of that in our very first discussion. From 1909 onward, writes Dr. Shamdasani, in Vienna, the psychoanalyst Herbert Silberer conducted experiments on himself in hypnagogic states. Silberer attempted to allow images to appear. These images, he maintained, presented symbolic depictions of his previous train of thought. Silberer corresponded with Jung and sent him offprints of his articles. I may interject here that Herbert Silberer became a martyr to the deeper aspects of psychology, because he presented his manuscript, which actually was entitled, or the title included the word alchemy, to his own teacher, Freud, who very vehemently disapproved of it, and Silberer went home and committed suicide. In 1912, Ludwig Staudenmayer, a professor of experimental chemistry, published a work entitled Magic as an Experimental Science. Staudenmayer had embarked on self-experimentations in 1901, commencing with automatic writing. A series of characters appeared, and he found that he no longer needed to conduct dialogues with them. He also induced acoustic and visual hallucinations. The aim of his enterprise was to use his self-experimentation to provide a scientific explanation of magic. He argued that the key to understanding magic lay in the concepts of hallucinations and the underconsciousness, as he called it, Unterbewusstsein, and gave particular importance to the role of personifications. Thus we see that Jung's procedure closely resembled a number of historical and contemporary practices with which he was familiar. From December 1913 onward, he carried on in the same procedure, deliberately evoking a fantasy in a waking state and then entering into it as into a drama. These fantasies, which I still think is a bad word for them, but more about that later in our talk, these fantasies may be understood as a type of dramatized thinking in pictorial form. In reading his fantasies, the impact of Jung's mythological studies is clear. Some of the figures and conceptions derived directly from his readings, and the form and style bear witness to his fascination with the world of myth and epic. In the black books, Jung wrote down his fantasies in dated entries. You will see some of those black books when the exhibit comes to Los Angeles or anywhere else where the exhibit is, Washington, D.C., because a number of the black books, which were the original record of his visions, are exhibited there. And you need to remember the black books were all dated. The visions were dated. This is what he saw this day. This is what he saw the other day. And when they were transcribed, they went through several transcriptions until they were entered into the calligraphed final version into the red book. By then, the dating was no longer present. All right, in the black books, Jung wrote down these fantasies, together with reflections on his state of mind and on his difficulties in comprehending the fantasies. The black books are not diaries of events, and very few dreams are noted in them. Rather, they are the records of an experiment. In December 1913, he referred to the first of the black books as the book of my most difficult experiment. In retrospect, he recalled that his scientific question was to see what took place when he switched off consciousness. Most of us think that when we switch off consciousness, we pass out, you know, but that was obviously not the case. The example of dreams indicated the existence of background activity, and he wanted to give this a possibility of emerging just as one does when taking mescaline. I refer to this already. This is Shandasamy's statement. I'll say perhaps a little more about that sort of thing later, but with the assistance of one of my good friends, we ascertained that mescaline was indeed isolated, not synthesized yet, but isolated from peyote by that time, and various people were experimenting with it. So that this is therefore a valid observation, but it by no means indicates that Jung took it himself. In fact, owing to the fact that he went for such a long time with such great frequency into these states, he literally would have had to consume probably the warehouses full of mescaline if that is what he was doing. And such was, of course, not the case. But it is interesting that Dr. Shamdasani, who probably is the man who is most familiar with what Jung did and when and how by now, because he studied it for so many years in anticipation of the publication of the Red Book, that Dr. Shamdasani should mention that at least as an analogy to what was happening with Jung's mind. In an entry in his dream book on April 17, 1917, Jung noted, quote, since then, frequent exercises in the emptying of consciousness, period. His procedure was clearly intentional. While its aim was to allow psychic contents to appear spontaneously, he recalled that beneath the threshold of consciousness, everything was animated. At times it was as if he heard something. At other times he realized that he was whispering to himself. From November 1913 to the following July, he remained uncertain of the meaning and significance of the undertaking, and concerning the meaning of his fantasies, which continued to develop. During this time, Philemon, who would prove to be an important figure in subsequent visions, appeared in a dream. Jung recounted, this is the quotation, this is from Memories, Dreams, Reflections, so you know, you can find it anytime there. There was a blue sky like the sea, covered not by clouds, but by flat brown clods of earth. It looked as if the clods were breaking apart, and the blue water of the sea were becoming visible between them. But the water was the blue sky. Suddenly there appeared from the right a winged being sailing across the sky. I saw that it was an old man with the horns of a bull. He held a bunch of four keys, one of which he clutched as if he were about to open a lock. He had the wings of the kingfisher with its characteristic colors. Since I did not understand this dream image, I painted it in order to impress it upon my memory. While he was painting this image, he found a dead kingfisher, which is very rarely found in the vicinity of Zurich, in his garden by the lake shore. Synchronicity, which of course he did not write about synchronicity yet. The date of this dream is not clear. The figure of Philemon first appears in the black books on January 27, 1914, but without kingfisher wings. To Jung, Philemon represented superior insight and was like a guru to him. He would converse with him in the garden. He recalled that Philemon evolved out of the figure of Elijah, who had previously appeared in his fantasies and in the Red Book. Another quotation from Memories, Dreams, Reflections. Philemon was a pagan and brought with him an Egypto-Hellenic atmosphere with a Gnostic coloration. Gnostic with a capital G. It was he who taught me psychic objectivity, the reality of the psyche. Through the conversations with Philemon, the distinction was carried between myself and the object of my thought. Psychologically, Philemon represented superior insight. And that will be the last quotation in this series from the Red Book. What did Jung really do then to induce this profound and altered state of consciousness? This is really the main question for us this evening, and I dare say perhaps for many evenings and mornings and days to come. What did he do? Some hints are given to us in the just quoted passage from Dr. Shandasani. There are at least two others. One is in Memories, Dreams, Reflection, where it is reported that in 1913, probably on December the 12th, Jung let himself fall. This is the direct quotation, into a kind of abyss, and this was the beginning of his entry into the mysterious realm. Some 12 years after this occurrence in 1925, Jung delivered a seminar on analytical psychology where he describes a variation on the above theme. Here he says that while sitting at his desk, he imagined himself digging a hole. The work was arduous and eventually more than a little dirty, for he found himself now in a horizontal tunnel which led to a cave where a scarab was floating, and ultimately a large number of snakes became active, somewhat to his discomfort, as hinted at in Memories, Dreams, Reflections, and a little more elaborately described in the Red Book. We can see that Jung had developed techniques that would change the focus of his consciousness and would take him into the strange world that subsequently he would call by the somewhat prosaic name, the collective unconscious. I might even venture to suggest, with all due respect to everyone concerned, particularly to Jung, that a great many of the terms that he devised to denominate various conditions of awareness of the collective unconscious and of others, that these terms served as much to disguise the true character of these states as they served to describe them, for very good reasons. Yet another very significant document exists in which Jung tries to describe the process of making effective contact with the deep or collective unconscious. In 1916, the very year when the seven sermons and the goodly latter portion of the scrutinies portion of the Red Book were revealed to Jung, he wrote an essay entitled in German, Die Transzendente Funktion. The essay was allowed to lay concealed until the mid-1950s. A slight similarity with the Red Book itself, which was concealed from public view since the 1920s until its publication in 2009, a somewhat longer period. Unlike with the Red Book, however, Jung had the opportunity to partially rewrite and revise this essay. After being published twice, once in English and once in German, it was eventually included in Jung's Collective Writings Volume 8, the Volume 8 being entitled The Structure and Dynamics of the Psyche. But the title of the essay is The Transcendent Function. We shall now briefly review the most pertinent features of this essay and try to comment on them as cogently as we may. In the prefatory note to the published version, Jung wrote a very telling account which enjoyed the benefit of many years of experiment with and by patients, and of course in addition to his own, experiments with a method involving the transcendent function, a method which came to be called and still is called active imagination. Now this is a prefatory note that Jung wrote in 1958. So he really has the benefit of all those years of dealing with the material and so forth. I'll only read part of this to you. He starts out the prefatory note. This is how it starts. It's very, very interesting. This is the question posed by the philosophy of India and particularly by Buddhism and Zen. Indirectly, it is the fundamental question in practice of all religions and all philosophies. For the unconscious is not this thing or that, it is the unknown with a capital U, as it immediately affects us. That's the first paragraph. The method of active imagination hereinafter described is the most important auxiliary for the production of those contents of the unconscious which lie, as it were, immediately below the threshold of consciousness, and when intensified, are the most likely to erupt spontaneously into the conscious mind. The method, therefore, is not without its dangers and should, if possible, not be employed except under expert supervision. One of the lesser dangers is that the procedure may not lead to any positive result, and these dangers actually are described in the essay subsequently. But he concludes his essay by saying, there can be no doubt that this is an invaluable auxiliary for the psychotherapist. So this needs to be therefore kept in mind. We can see from this that no doubt encouraged by Jung and by some of his disciples, some Jungian analysants have practiced something not unlike the methods employed by Jung in writing the Red Book, and that this was particularly a reasonably frequent phenomenon in the early days of the history of the analytical psychological movement. We can also conclude that unlike Jung's own experiment of this kind, their experiments often did not succeed that well. Now, the essay at first defines the nature and relationship of conscious and unconscious, or in German, Bewusstsein und das Unbewusste. A conscious psyche or consciousness, as Jung says, is extremely important, for without it any kind of culture and of civilization would be impossible. At the same time, there are in every civilization, as he says, great artists and others distinguished by creative gifts, these are Jung's own words, who operate precisely by way of the permeability, quote, separating the conscious and the unconscious. So while much of society relies on the continuity and reliability of the consciousness of its members, the creative minority of society does not. The tendency of the consciousness of the ego is, however, to reject whatever appears as incompatible with itself. But this judgment is in turn exercised by a consciousness that is, in Jung's word, partial and prejudiced. And consciousness always judges by way of that which is known, and thus that which is new, and which, once again, quote, under certain conditions might considerably enrich the directed process, is routinely excluded. That is how our minds work in general. Thus a certain one-sidedness arises. So civilization literally demands one-sidedness in the sense that it concentrates on directed consciousness, for in order to concentrate on the rational and the directed, it must exclude or dissociate itself from the unconscious. Jung then enumerates various shortcomings of therapy and analysis. And this is very cute, because if nowadays we do this sort of thing, we arouse the ire not only of analysts and therapists, but of analysants who have sort of invested their analysis with something very much resembling a religious significance. And even as in religious groups, let's say the valuation of the religious commitment often is greatly intensified by the amount of contributions of a pecuniary nature that a person makes to the church or organization, so the amount of money invested in analysis and therapy also causes a great deal of religious reverence for the process in most or in many cases. Freud knew this very well, and therefore he invested the issue of paying your bill to the analyst or the therapist with a great deal of tremendously profound significance, or at least so he said. Now, so then Jung speaks of this, and he says such procedures, namely analysis, therapy, and so forth, cannot anticipate novel developments, and thus it often occurs that new difficulties arise. Not even analysis constitutes ever, he says, a unique cure. Using, again, cure in quotation marks. Why? Because difficulties continue to exist in life. And it is essential, however, that there should be a healthy and open attitude toward the unconscious, for without it, the influences of the unconscious cannot be conveyed to the ego. Certainly everyone who in some fashion or the other is involved with this field or knows about it can testify to that. And not only in terms of the psychoanalytic attempts to open up the unconscious and the resistance against that, but others. We mentioned mescaline a while ago, and, you know, since the 1960s, for at least a period of time, there were therapeutic efforts involving psychedelics, and there also the reaction, the resistance of some patients to the kind of opening that occurs as the result of that substance was frequently monumental. I know of some cases where, having been administered the MDMA, known popularly as ecstasy, the patient just plain would pass out. The resistance against what was occurring was so powerful. Bad trips, so-called, with LSD, mescaline, and others bear testimony to the same thing. Similarly, let's say, events, occurrences that sometimes happen spontaneously to people, along perhaps a parapsychological line, the appearance of ghosts, of telepathy, of phenomena of that sort, frequently meet with a great and violent resistance on the part of the people to whom they happen. This is the resistance of the conscious ego against the opening of the unconscious. Jung defines the agency that mediates between conscious and unconscious, and in practice acts as a kind of gatekeeper to the mystery within. He describes it in the following manner. The tendencies of the conscious and the unconscious are the two factors that together make up the transcendent function. It is called transcendent because it makes the transition from one attitude to another organically possible without loss of the unconscious. The constructive or synthetic method or treatment presupposes insights which are at least potentially present in the patient and can therefore be made conscious. If the analyst knows nothing of these potentialities, he cannot help the patient to develop them either. Unless analyst and patient together devote proper scientific study to this problem, which as a rule is out of the question. This has, of course, to do with the fact that has been expressed metaphorically elsewhere by Jung and others, that no therapist, no analyst can take a patient further than he has gone himself or herself. So it is this function, this transcendent function, that is stimulated and enlivened by an analyst of Jungian training, for such a person helps to bring conscious and unconscious together. The analyst becomes a sort of combination of gatekeeper of the unconscious and the psychopomp guide within that same realm. In Jungian analysis, this is regarded as a manifestation of the transference, an emotionally fueled connectedness of analyst and an Alicent. The Freudian view of this process would be that it has its historical roots, you guessed it, in the infantile sexuality of the patient. Jung says in his essay that the understanding of the transference is to be sought not in its historical antecedents, but in its purpose. What then is required in the long run to develop the transcendent function? What is needed is unconscious material for consciousness to deal with. Psychoanalysis's great discovery initially was the availability for this purpose of dreams. Jung agrees that dreams are valuable disclosures of the unconscious, but he says, and I quote, "In general, dreams are unsuitable or difficult to make use of in developing the transcendent function, because they make two great demands on the subject." Jung mentions some minor sources of unconscious disclosure, and then he goes on saying as follows. Another source is spontaneous fantasies. Now we are sort of coming closer to our subject proper. They usually have a more composed and coherent character and often contain much that is obviously significant. Some patients are able to produce fantasies at any time, allowing them to rise up freely simply by eliminating critical attention. Such fantasies can be used, though this particular talent is none too common. The capacity to produce free fantasies can, however, be developed with practice. The training consists first of all in systematic exercises for eliminating critical attention, thus producing a vacuum in consciousness. This encourages the emergence of any fantasies that are lying in readiness. A prerequisite, of course, is that fantasies with a high libido charge are actually lying ready. That is naturally not always the case. Where this is not, special measures are required. Jung also says that the unconscious has a natural tendency to exercise what he calls a counteraction to the conscious. The unconscious has its own agenda. These are our words, mine. And certainly its own wisdom, whereby it could regulate the conscious ego in certain ways if it were not prevented from doing so by the directedness, the purposefulness, and what we might also call the self-confidence of the conscious ego. If you pardon me for mentioning such a trivial metaphor, but I am reminded of a rural Hungarian image which has to do with the bumblebee who flew one Sunday morning into the church steeple. The bumblebee sat on the bell, and when the sexton down below in the church started pulling the rope, the bumblebee explained, "Behold, I am ringing the bell." Now you see this, I am using this as a metaphor for the excessive and often inaccurate self-centeredness and self-importance of the ego. The ego thinks that it is the boss, it does everything and will not consider the activities of anything else, such as influences from the unconscious, which may actually be quite important in the picture. So the unconscious seldom has a chance to have any real impact or input into the business of the conscious. Its voice is muted and overpowered. Jung mentions a very dramatic incident. A person known to Jung had a dream in which he stepped out into space from the top of a mountain. Jung told him that this might be a warning from his unconscious and that he might want to abstain from dangerous mountaineering. A few months later, the person in question stepped off into space on one of the mountains and was killed. He didn't heed the warning. In not quite such deadly, dramatic ways, hopefully, I think many of us have partaken of such experiences. To my considerable relief and to the distress of many of my friends, I never learned to drive a car. I shared that with some others, you know, of course, like the great writer Ray Bradbury, but unfortunately I don't share his talents in other areas. But in any event, in spite of that, just sitting in the driver's seat, I think I couldn't count the number of incidents when I got a strong feeling, let's not drive down this road. And inevitably something happened. Most of the time we got a ticket, making a wrong turn or something like that. And another time, sometimes these things are then reinforced by synchronicities. I well remember one time in a similar condition, but out on the freeway traveling toward Ojai, Santa Barbara. Persistently in front of us, there drove a car with the license plate starting with P-E-H, Pech. Now this is of course the letter of the path on the Tree of Life to which the lightning struck tower is assigned in the Golden Dawn system and which indicates accident, you know, disaster, difficulty. And I said, you know, we got to get off this road. We got to somehow get away from that car. Sure enough, we had a flat tire very soon thereafter. Then the other car took off, you know, because apparently, you know, the work had been achieved. But it wasn't, of course, a very serious matter. It was nevertheless there. Now, you know, these things, when recounted like this, sound so trivial, but they are really the manifestations of the same principle. The unconscious knows something and is trying to get through, but for a variety of reasons, its intimations are not being paid sufficient attention to, and then one learns, you know, what may happen. Jung advises what he calls spontaneous fantasies to call up the unconscious into consciousness. We already mentioned something about that, but here is a bit more. Let's see what we may find. If there is no capacity to produce fantasies freely, we have to resort to artificial aid. The reason for invoking such aid is generally a depressed or disturbed state of mind for which no adequate cause can be found. Naturally, the patient can give any number of rationalistic reasons. The bad weather alone suffices as a reason. But none of them is really satisfying as an explanation. For a causal explanation of these states is usually satisfying only to an outsider and then only up to a point. The outsider is content if his causal requirements are more or less satisfied. It is sufficient for him to know where the thing comes from. He does not feel the challenge which for the patient lies in the depression, in the feeling, you know. The German words of a famous German song, originally a ballad, a poem, come to mind from the Lorelei, I believe. Ich weiß nicht, was soll es bedeuten, dass ich so traurig bin. I don't know what it could mean that I am so sad. And then, you know, the poem goes on. This is the kind of thing, this kind of mood that we are talking about. The patient would like to know what it is all for and how to gain relief. In the intensity of the emotional disturbance itself lies the value, the energy which he should have at his disposal in order to remedy the state of reduced adaptation. Nothing is achieved by repressing this state or devaluing it rationally. So states of mind and moods of this sort can themselves act as the openers of the way, because in their energy, in the tone of their feeling, there is a way in which we can make contact with the unconscious. Then, after outlining a more verbal conceptual method of fantasy, he wrote this: a note must be introduced now at this point, once again, about the word fantasy. I've been bothered by this throughout the last 12 lectures, and finally I came across a statement by Jung himself, albeit made quite later in life, where he corrected that. This is in the 18th volume of the collected writings, which is the last volume pretty much of the collected writings on his Tavistock lectures. The Tavistock lectures were lectures delivered in London. And here is what Jung said: I really prefer the term imagination to fantasy, because there is a difference between the two which the old doctors had in mind when they said opus nostrum, our work, ought to be done per veram imaginationem et not fantastica, by true imagination and not by a fantastical one. When he talks about the old doctors, he's primarily referring here to alchemists, because this, of course, was, these lectures were delivered at a time when he was already very conversant with alchemy. In other words, he goes on, if you take the correct meaning of this definition, fantasy is merely nonsense, a phantasm, a fleeting impression, but imagination is active, purposeful creation. And this is exactly the distinction I make too. A fantasy is more or less your own invention and remains on the surface of personal things and conscious expectations. But active imagination, as the term denotes, means that the images have a life of their own and that the symbolic events develop according to their own logic. That is, of course, if your conscious reason does not interfere. I think this is important to keep in mind. It would seem that Jung came to this conclusion after working intensively with alchemical literature. There was another good quotation here which I may have missed, so I better read it to you. Let's see now. The emotional disturbance in the psyche can also be dealt with in another way, not by clarifying it intellectually, but by giving it visible shape. Patients who possess some talent for drawing or painting can give expression to their mood by means of a picture. It is not important for the picture to be technically or aesthetically satisfying, but merely for the fantasy to have free play and for the whole thing to be done as well as possible. In principle, this procedure agrees with others described, and I'll come to that. Here, too, a product is created which is influenced by both conscious and unconscious, embodying the striving of the unconscious for the light and the striving of the conscious for substance. And prior to that, he wrote, in order, therefore, to gain possession of the energy that is in the wrong place, one must make the emotional state the basis or starting point of the procedure. You know, you have to catch the feeling. What kind of feeling is coming up from the unconscious? What is over there? What is this not understood feeling that is percolating to the surface? These are, of course, my own words. He must make himself as conscious as possible of the mood he is in, sinking himself in it without reserve and noting down on paper all the fantasies and other associations that come up. Fantasy must be allowed the freest possible play, yet not in such a manner that it leaves the orbit of its object, namely the affect, by setting off a kind of chain reaction association process. So the danger with this one, which is not as visual as the other that we mentioned, is that a free association may occur. And he mentions that this free association, as Freud called it, leads away from the object to all sorts of complexes, and one can never be sure that they relate to the affect and are not displacements which have appeared in its stead. Many years ago, one of my teachers, the late Professor Ernest Wood, was trying to, in terms of the meditation practices, some of which are really not that far from what we are talking about here, used to say that concentration is extremely important for effective meditation. And he said, what you need to avoid in concentration, and what really concentration is designed to avoid, is precisely the moving away from the original object by way of free association. And, you know, he used as sort of a trivial example, say you are concentrating on milk. He said, now, a thought will come up associated with it by free association, maybe white. And then from the white, or maybe even before, it may jump to butter. From butter, it may jump to scrambled eggs with butter. And it goes on and on and on and on, and before you know it, it has wandered so far away from the original image that it's completely gone. And so he says, concentration doesn't mean that you are just thinking milk, 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 and exclude everything else, but that when an association arises, you come back to the original, you come back to the original, and don't allow the butterfly mind to fly from one flower to the other. And that indeed may be a little bit of a useful analogy here also. So really what we have is there are two kinds. One of them, you move with the feeling that comes up from the unconscious and try to get its meaning, and you go deeper and deeper into it. With the other one, you allow imagery to arise, and both of these have their dangers. Because when this spontaneous artistic activity takes place, of which certainly Jung gave fabulous examples in the illustrations in the Red Book, or which have been included in the Red Book. Some of them don't really illustrate any of the text in the Red Book, but are just there. There, the difficulty is that the artistically inclined person, who is most likely, of course, to do that, now will consider the production of the imagination primarily in the line of art. And now it will turn into art instead of being regarded as a genuine product of the deeper reality of the unconscious. Because an artist will automatically, immediately do that. And now it becomes art and becomes my art. Look what I have painted, you know, and so forth. And once again, really the purpose for which that imagery came forward is no longer considered. So often, however, says Jung, we find cases where there is no tangible mood or depression at all, but just a general dull discontent, a feeling of resistance to everything. I think he was writing about me. A sort of boredom or vague disgust, an indefinable but excruciating emptiness. I think this is the natural reaction of the Gnostic to the world. In these cases, no definite starting point exists. It will first have to be created. Here, a special introversion of the energy, which he calls libido, is necessary, supported perhaps by favorable external conditions, such as complete rest, especially at night, when the libido energy has in any case a tendency to introversion. He quotes Nietzsche, "This night now do all fountains speak louder, and my soul also is a bubbling fountain." Thus Jung gives his initial advice about what eventually came to be called active imagination. Almost incredibly, to me anyway, Jung even says, and I quote, that "rarer but equally valuable is automatic writing, direct or with the planchette." You know, the planchette is something that you use in a Ouija board. "These two yields useful results." Now, I have generally always considered automatic writing a lowly and also somewhat dangerous practice, but apparently if it's done correctly, it, even that can be used to this end. So at present, in possession of the Red Book and its contents, we can see that Jung was reporting here in this essay from the storehouse of his experiences between 1913 and 1916. The latter date being the one when he wrote the essay on the transcendent function. Jung then asks a rather portentous question. What is to be done with the material obtained in one of the manners described? So the first question is, what is the practice? How do we get to that opening? And then what do we do when the material comes to us? He states that so far as his experience goes, and these are his words, "Now we know, of course, that this experience was the material in the Red Book. So far as his experience goes, there appear to be two tendencies. And he calls these, first, creative formulation and understanding. Creative formulation seems to move along artistic lines and leads to aesthetic avenues of formulation. And the other consists of the intensive struggle to understand the meaning of the product of the imaginal process." And Jung is quite insistent that neither of these can be ordered or willed. And that, of course, is, I think, our problem, and that will be the problem, I think, of many of us when approaching this, because from the point of view of the ego, we feel that if something can happen, it ought to happen in response to our command, you know. And if it doesn't happen, well, then the whole thing is probably balderdash. I can't make it happen, therefore it can't happen, therefore I better go on to something else. But once again, we have to remember one of my favorite quotations from Jung, "I don't make myself, I happen to myself." Because in this statement, as indeed in some others, there is enshrined the key notion, really, of Jung, that something is trying to happen within us. And that is not, it is not a matter of making anything, forcing anything, contriving anything, but allowing something to take place. This is one of the keynotes that subsequently made Jung, one of several keynotes, rather interested in certain aspects of Taoism. And the first lecture that I'm going to give on alchemy will be on the secret of the golden flower, which is a Taoist scripture, because that was the first alchemical scripture, albeit Chinese alchemical, which is very, very different from Western alchemy, that Jung was confronted with, but in it he could see that it really pertained to the same process whereby he received the Red Book. And then he went, so to say, from there. But there, in other words, there has to be a relaxed, permissive, open attitude to the process, where the most that the ego can do is to act as a benign facilitator and observer of what is taking place. But that is very, very difficult for most of us because, of course, we live in a culture, and indeed even our own personal culture, that is very ego-oriented, that is very ego-dominated. So then, as I mentioned before, the one of artistic or creative formulation is, there is the danger there is that the artistic considerations overpower the transcendent functional aspects. The other, having to do with understanding, is accompanied by intellectual analysis and interpretation, and the content is frequently overvalued. So when now the thinking function of the ego goes to work on the material, it intellectualizes it. It makes something mental and intellectual out of it. And thus we get all sorts of mental and occult and prophetic interpretations, sometimes of an outrageously extravagant character. I can certainly testify to that, because in my long undistinguished career, I got more communications, primarily letters, from people who are saviors, who are agents of saviors, who are Jesus Christ, filled with wild prophecies, including of an apocalyptic character. And I would say that the overwhelming majority of these people, as far as I can tell, you know, had probably a fairly genuine experience of the transcendent function. But then the mind goes to work on it and puts it into categories, in these cases primarily categories that are in some way or the other exalting the ego of the person. You see, I am the savior. I am the visionary. I am the prophet. To me are given the great and the wonderful things that you should humbly listen to and communicate and possibly publish. That's what they want me to do. As if I were a publisher of balderdash. I mean, I'm not even the publisher of anything else. I have to give my own balderdash to a publisher to be published. But so you can see what, you know, what happens. The danger is twofold. First, that the essentially symbolic character of the imaginative process is lost, factualized, you know. And there are various reasons for that, but one of them, of course, is also that we are not sufficiently aware of the importance of the value, indeed of the tremendous potential of symbols and of a symbolic communication. And therefore we push that away. We try to factualize it, we try to intellectualize it, we try to turn it into concept, or we try to turn it into fact. And the second danger is that the understanding of the meaning of the product of the experiencing subject is lost. Enumerating the pitfalls and the difficulties, Jung concludes his essay as follows: "But where the necessary premises exist, the transcendent function not only forms a valuable addition to psychotherapeutic treatment, but gives the patient the inestimable advantage of assisting the person in his own resources and of breaking the dependence, which is often felt as humiliating." Dependence on the therapist. Mm-hmm. It takes a good therapist to discourage that also. "It is a way of attaining liberation by one's own efforts and of finding the courage to be oneself." This, of course, expressed in other ways and in primarily symbolic ways, is a very important element in the Red Book, because the term appears over and over again, where the soul or various other important figures, Philemon or others, tell Jung, "Now live your life." And by living your life, they mean precisely, as appears in the context of the material, precisely the life where the conscious and the unconscious freely communicate with each other and create the kind of psychic wealth that makes for a truly worthwhile life. So when the Red Book says, live your life, it is that kind of life, the psycho-spiritually aware life that they are talking about. Not just any kind of life. And this puts the, let's say, the whole issue that the existentialists struggled with so hard and others of authenticity into a somewhat different context once again. The authentic life is the life that is lived from the wholeness of one's being. What is that wholeness? That wholeness is the conscious and the so-called unconscious. The external and the internal, that of which we are aware right now, and that of which we ought to be aware, and we become aware. When these come together and operate together, then we are living out of the wholeness of our being, and that is the authentic life. Those are really very important considerations. We can easily see that most of these conclusions reached by Jung have come from experiences with the Red Book. Now we have that key. So when we look at the various psychological writings, certainly when we look at the alchemical writing, we can always see, this is part of the process that was started in the Red Book. This is an application of the experiences of the Red Book. So now we have the key which enriches and inspirits and enlightens the entirety of the Jungian opus, Jung's work. In fact, Dr. Shamdasani, I think, very, very cogently stated that, and I may or may not have mentioned that before, that the Red Book will do to the study and the understanding of C.G. Jung what the discovery and the exegesis of the Nag Hammadi library did to the study of Gnosticism. So up to this time, we only knew even though it's 18 volumes in the collected writings, it's really only a fragment. Only with the addition of the Red Book will it become complete and will it become fully understandable. And that certainly to someone like myself who, since my childhood, certainly since my teens, was, you know, intensely occupied with Gnosticism or whatever I could get hold of from the Gnostic tradition, that statement of Dr. Shamdasani is very, very true. Because within an incredibly short time, the entire approach to, the entire view, the entire internal and external way of dealing with the Gnostic tradition changed as the result of the material in the Nag Hammadi library. Now people knew what this was all about. Before that, you had to be very intuitive, like Jung or others. And if you were not, then it was, as so many of the scholars said, well, bunch of nonsense. You wonder, if that's what it is, then why did they choose that as an academic discipline? I don't think I would. Just like people, it always astonishes me that people write biographies of individuals whom they hate. You know? Not even just dislike, but hate. But for God's sakes, why would I spend my time and my energy and the ribbon in my typewriter, which I would still do, since I wouldn't write on the computer. on somebody whom I dislike. Am I going to write a biography of Lenin? Yeah, you got something else coming. Of course I wouldn't. But people do that. In the same way, people, academicians will take to a particular academic discipline which they devalue and which they say bad things about all the time. It became impossible regarding Gnosticism. And I think much of it will become impossible regarding Jung, but certainly an entire new dimension of Jung's opus will now come to the fore. Now, as time passed, some Jungians became fond of what was at first called visioning, believe it or not, visioning, and later active imagination. But the results were predominantly unsatisfactory. Also, Jung managed by 1930 to increasingly recast the method and the content of his own visioning into the terminology of alchemy, which proved very useful to Jung. Meanwhile, the Red Book was concealed at Jung's residence, and only rumors of Jung's visionary powers were abroad. There was very little change in this situation until our own days, or more precisely until October of 2009, when the previously secret Liber Novus or Red Book became generally available. It is very likely that a novel situation will arise now, wherein the emphasis of Jungian thought will probably shift from concern with therapy to what? To visionary insight. And more individuals will experiment with vision or active imagination, thus attempting to emulate Jung. Whether Jungian analysts and therapists will welcome such developments is a matter of question. It is likely that some of them at least will not. It may very well happen that Jung will appear more and more as a healer of the culture and of humanity, and less the originator of just one kind of therapeutical method among many. Now, Jung himself said that. Really, the method of therapy is not particularly important. What is important is the therapist. The therapist. You see, a good therapist can work with this theory or that, and is still going to obtain good results. I wonder whether too many Jungians have really taken that to heart, but it is certainly an important issue. The content of the Red Book would indicate that such might have been the role, namely the role of a healer of the culture and of humanity, and not just the originator of a particular theory of therapy, that this kind of a role might have been the one assigned to Jung from the beginning, and that, as he called it, the spirit of the times and associated conditions prevented him from fulfilling it in the 20th century. But what did not come to pass in the 20th, may very well come forth in the 21st. It is not up to us to know whether this will be indeed thus. What appertains to us at this time is to effectively ask and answer the question Jung posed in his essay on the transcendent function. What is to be done with the material obtained in the manner described? Our minds must exclude a priori answers. We need to confront, amplify, and ultimately assimilate the manifestations of the mystery touched by Jung. The content of the Red Book has many messages, meanings, and indeed levels of interpretation. We ought to familiarize ourselves with as many of these as possible. In the Red Book, there is symbol and fact, collective message and individual psychological meaning, the latter addressed to Jung, but through him to all people, what in German may be called Jedermann, every man. In conclusion, let us mention a few points that emerge for our edification from the Red Book, recognizing that these by no means exhaust the treasure trove of meaning and wisdom present therein. So by way of a collectively and individually valid message, relevant to the entire Western culture and to a lesser degree to the entire world, we have the following. 3 points. 1. That a new gnosis is coming into the world. one which is destined to replace or radically modify the spiritual underpinnings of Western culture. This gnosis is destined to replace the monotheistic God image of the Old Testament that was inherited by Christianity and Islam. What is needed is neither the traditional monotheism nor the fashionable secularism, but a multi-centered God image wherein the God resident within the depths of the human psyche plays a role of permanent importance. While the new religion embodying this will probably take about 800 years to develop, according to the Red Book, which you may remember, actually now probably not much more than 700 years. There you are. 1913, 1916, I mean, look, it's 100 years ago. It is essential that human beings address themselves to the task of realizing its truths at the present time. Secondly, the second point, the great practical task underlying the new religion is the effective awakening of the God that slumbers in human nature. This task is not so much an event as a process, the latter consisting of a reconciliation and union of the opposites, such as masculine and feminine, light and darkness, thinking and feeling, earth and heaven, ego and shadow, and many more. The path of spiritual development indicated is not unidirectional, but encompassing and uniting all dualities. In this respect, much of the one-sidedness of the conventional Christian message must be abrogated or radically revised. The task is both individual and collective. Last but not least, the new gnosis, rather like the gnosis of the ancient Gnostics, is not theoretical and theological, not dogmatic and ethical. Thinking will not bring us this gnosis any more than believing or following rules. It is something that must happen within ourselves, although we may facilitate it in certain ways. Active imagination of the kind present in the Red Book being one of the ways. Somehow while I was reading these, I was taken back to the seven sermons to the dead, wherein after certain utterances, according to the Red Book of Philemon, the dead say contemptuously, "We have known all of this for a long time." Somehow that is what I hear coming to me from the ether when I say this. This is nothing new, you know. We have known this for a long time. Have we really? Yes, words of this sort we are familiar with, indeed. But have we done any of it? No. No. Certainly, as concepts and as precepts, these have existed for a long time. But as a living reality in our practice, they have not. And that is what is required at this time. And that is what Jung calls attention to. So I sort of see Jung there, wherever he was, you know, struggling with this material and making notes into his black book and things, saying, "Look, I am doing it. And I dearly hope that at least to some extent and degree, according to their ability, but with full commitment, other people will do the same. Because otherwise, why have I done this?" Okay? So this is the great issue now. We have talked about these things. We have written about these things. And no doubt a few mystics and a few Gnostics and a few Sufis, sophisticated people, have done much of it too. But it wasn't really done in sufficient numbers and probably with sufficient and lasting intensity. Our world is in a crisis, more than one crisis, not just a economic crisis which it experienced many times before and which are cyclic and all, but it is in a psycho-spiritual crisis. Indeed, as Philemon hears the dead exclaim, "Where is God? Is God dead?" Then he tries to explain to them that the real deity is not dead, but something is dead, and something is dying, and therefore something has to come forth. And Jung stated elsewhere, and I think it's a very, very important statement, only religion can replace religion. So as, let's say, the old-time religion is passing, well, you know, if you go to the mega churches and things like that, then you're not going to see that, but it is. As the old-time religion is passing, secularism is not going to replace it. The New Age is not going to replace it. Marxism and fascism and Nazism tried to replace it, and look how that went. Something of a religious nature has to replace it. And Jung felt that indeed that religion is embodied, at least in its main outline, in the Red Book. In the seventh black book, entered on the relatively late date of January 5th, 1922, we have a record of a conversation of Jung with his soul. And here he called for his soul. He says, "Come, I need to talk to you." And the soul came. And this conversation concerns the Red Book and the, let's say, the bringing forth of the message of the Red Book. And beyond it, an ongoing work resulting from this. I will quote here only a few excerpts from that conversation, but they will serve, I think, as well. The soul says, "The great work begins." Jung, "What great work?" Soul, "The work that should now be undertaken. It is a great and difficult work." Jung, "What is it? Speak." Typical of his conversations, you know. Soul, "You should listen. To no longer be a Christian is easy. But what next? For more is yet to come. Everything is waiting for you, but you should speak." Jung, "What is my calling?" Soul, "The new religion and its proclamation." I repeat that again. "The new religion and its proclamation." Jung says, "Oh God, how should I do this?" The soul, "Do not be of such little faith. No one knows it as you do. There is no one who could say it as well as you do." As I mentioned, the conversation is longer, but these are, I think, the salient features. And I would venture to suggest that indeed no one has said it as well as he did. And we have seen and heard it from him. Here we have received it from his magical prophetic book in the red cover, from his astonishing calligraphy, from his sublime pictures, from his translated words. And through these, from the great mystery which he contacted, and which perhaps more importantly contacted him. And at the center of that mystery, a strange and yet to me utterly real figure, Philemon, identified as the embodiment of Simon Magus. And speaking for myself and perhaps for some of my close friends and associates, we who are the heirs of Simon Magus as Gnostics have heard, and we shall not forget. We shall not forget now and not forever. Thank you.
Copyright and Main Text by BC Recording. Catalog number 200513. For more information about available lecture titles and for many other resources, visit gnosis.org. That's GNOSIS.org.